Good. So, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. I think it's about time we started. I know that you've had a good afternoon with your workshops, and welcome to this final session of this year's symposium. I'm going to start out by asking something which I don't think will be very controversial, which is this. Put your hand up if you think that all randomized trials and the data therefrom should be available to the public. Thank you. Keep your hands up, but put your hands down if you don't think that publicly funded Cochrane reviews should be accessible by the public.
The double negative.
Oh, no. Double negative is too different. Okay, put your hands down. Put your hands up if you think that if you don't think that publicly funded.
I'm glad you're not a journalist.
No, I'm good. So I really feel that my Jeremy Paxman moment isn't getting off to a good start here. The point I was hoping to make was that if we all feel strongly that trials should be available to the public, and I would argue that all the publicly funded Cochrane reviews should be available to everybody as well in as easy a format as possible. If we're producing this stuff, whether with public funds or not, it should be available. So one other poll, I hope this one will be rather easier. Hands up if you feel nervous about the media and what the media might do with your dealing with it. Okay, good, thank you. Well, we've invited our guests here this afternoon to try and bridge the gap between you as those that prepare Cochrane reviews and the world of the media. And I'm delighted to welcome them to the platform. Just to introduce them briefly, they're going to say a few words in a moment, but Kate Kelland on my left is health and science correspondent for Europe, the Middle East and Africa for Reuters, the international news agency. To her left, Tom Sheldon, the senior press manager at the Science Media Centre. Then, I would say our very own, Jamie Hartmann-Boyce, who's the ME of the Tobacco Addiction Group and a Cochrane author. And then, also our own, Joe Anthony and Katie Abbotts, who are our communications professionals within the collaboration. So it's great to have such a broad spectrum of speakers to talk to us this afternoon. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to invite our three visitors particularly to perhaps open with a few words. And what I've asked them to say is why they were keen to come to talk to us today, because I'm pleased to say they were keen and enthusiastic to do so. Perhaps their perspective on why we should be sharing our reviews, and perhaps a little bit about their link to Cochrane and the media. So, Kate, would you like to kick off
yes,
with that?
Yes, certainly. Good afternoon, everybody. I think it's important to come and engage in things like this because I am aware that there are still a large number of scientists who are worried about talking to the media, and part of the reason to come to things like this is because I think that I'd like to try and ease that relationship. Sorry. Shall I pin it?
It's on. Yeah.
Is that any better?
Yeah.
Oh yes. Okay. So part of the reason is that I think that tension in the relationship between scientists and journalists can be there's a possibility to ease that and to smooth out that relationship. I think that can help both sides of the equation. It makes my job easier. The more people and I can explain to how I go about my job and why I may cover one study and not cover another, the more I get the sort of material coming into my inbox which is more usable. And I think also it's important for scientists to communicate with people like me because I'm the person who communicates with the paying public, with the consumer, the end user of the drug or the science or the lifestyle advice or whatever it is. That's one of the reasons that I would be doing this.
Yeah, thank you. Tom, would you like to
same
sort of
quick?
Okay.
If this is working, I'll use this. Is that okay? Right, thank you for inviting me today. So, as
Martin said at the beginning, it might well be a laudable thing to make all Cochrane reviews freely available, but even if you did that, hardly any members of the public would read them. And that doesn't matter because they are still getting the information they need about science, health, the environment, and so on through other sources, but predominantly and consistently, whenever they're polled as to where they're getting that information from, it's through mass media sources, so as supplied by Reuters and as disseminated worldwide by places like the BBC, The Guardian, The Times, The Mail. So the reason that I've opened with that is because there is a chain of events that takes place between you doing your science and the public receiving that information. And I would argue strongly that your involvement does not end when you publish your review. I think it's very important for you to work with people like Joe and Katie in your press office, and if you don't know them already, please do get to know them because you've got a very good press office here. And you need to be actively engaged at every step in making sure that the public receive as accurately and as responsibly as possible the very hard work that you've already done in putting together your review. I mentioned the Daily Mail a minute ago, and I've been doing this job now for 9 years and talking to scientists. Generally, the Daily Mail is not their newspaper of choice, and it often attracts sort of snorts of derision. But I would champion the specialist correspondents. They have environment science and health specialist correspondents. They are very, very skillful people, but they need your help. They are not bad people. They are not out there to trap you. They are not there to kind of play tricks with your research. There are journalists like that, but they tend not to be the specialist correspondents that you need to be engaging with. Most correspondents, including at the Daily Mail, are good people who need a story but are not looking to report that inaccurately. And so I would finish by saying that a Daily Mail science journalist who doesn't work there anymore, but a few years ago I asked her what her daily routine was like, and she said, I get over 100 press releases in my inbox every day. I have to choose about 15 of them that are worthy of a story. I write 5 of them, they publish 2 of them, and then I go home and I come back the next day, and that's pretty much her day. Very, very difficult, even for a specialist, you know, a qualified PhD scientist to make sense of 100 press releases, 100 new research papers coming in every single day. So these journalists need your help in making sure that the public, whose opinions really matter because it can make the difference between about what government are going to do with your specialist area of science, are receiving the information as accurately as they possibly can.
Thanks. And Jamie, you're one of the people in Cochrane who's probably had more hands-on experience of this than most because of the reviews that you've been involved in. Would you like to say a little bit about why you're therefore so keen to sort of be part of this project?
Yeah, so I basically did a review of electronic cigarettes for smoking cessation. It's since been updated. So that's how I first got involved in kind of a media-worthy topic or something the media was really keen on. And before that, I was completely media naive, so I had zero involvement with the media besides one really embarrassing interview when I was like 14 in our local newspaper that I've never forgotten. So I kind of went into it with quite a bit of trepidation, and there was a lot in me that kept on being like, "Ooh, I don't know if you're the right person to be doing this, don't do it." But I think what I kept on focusing on, and one of the reasons I was keen to talk about it today, is that I do really believe we have a responsibility to share our research with the public, and I think that can take kind of a broad ethical standpoint of they're funding this, they deserve to know the results. But to me, I also kept focusing on uncertain moments. So for example, a cousin of my husband's who's a really heavy smoker said to me, "Well, I'm not going to try e-cigarettes. I know I can't quit smoking any other way, but I'm not going to try e-cigarettes because none of the scientists can agree about it, and everything I've heard on the news suggests that they're going to kill me as well." And I thought, actually, the evidence we have doesn't seem to suggest that, but in a lot of areas, as we heard yesterday, whoever shouts loudest gets their point across, and that's not right. You know, with cigarettes, quitting could could massively change people's lives. It could change their families' lives. And so we have a responsibility to get the information out there in as responsible and clear a manner as possible. So that's kind of where I come to this from.
Thank you. And I can't help but observe that we've only been going for 5 minutes and we've had a personal story already, and that's bound to be a good thing. Thank you. Tom, we're coming back to you first, if that's all right. Just ask him slightly more in-depth questions, if you grab the microphone there. I guess that you've alluded to the answer to the first one already, which was going to be, is there such a thing as good and bad journalism?
Huh. Yeah.
Okay. So should we be worried about trying to distinguish it into, when we're sitting where we're sitting, the fact that we know that there is that distinction, should it worry us or not? And how might we react to that knowledge?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. There's good and bad everything, isn't there? You will see, you read the papers every day, you'll find good and bad journalism all over the place. I think it would be, okay, so as scientists, you don't just want to be constantly on tap, picking up the phone, sort of blithely and naively to every journalist call that comes in, and talking to just anyone. There are, I don't want to name names because the same people who are bad journalists tend to be the most litigious people, but I get into real trouble. But there are people out there. There are opinion writers whose job is certainly not to portray the facts in an unbiased and fair way. And there are journalists who will try to, you know, they will take a line on something right from the outset, whether it's a climate skeptic line or whether it's an e-cigs are as bad as fags line or whatever it is. But then there's everybody else, and then, you know, there's people like Kate Cullen who are sort of among the very best journalists out there. And I find people read the news and then they remember something that was really bad. And then whenever you talk to them about the media, they say, oh yeah, I read this really bad article once, it said this sort of thing. I would never talk to a journalist. And if you think about it, that's just like the worst kind of cherry picking, the most unscientific approach to it that you could possibly have. Because there's a majority of journalists out there who are trying to do their job and will do their job better if you can help them. So yes, there's good and bad journalism, but you know, it's quite easy to find out with a quick Google search who are the bad ones. And plus, I haven't really said anything about where I work yet. I can come on to that.
No,
if do you'd
please
like,
tell us a bit about the Science Media Centre.
So we're a place that you can come to for impartial advice about whether to speak to a particular journalist, what might be the pitfalls in doing so, and you know, timing, and is there anything that you should be alarmed at or anything like that. So, but more broadly, we're a non-profit. We call ourselves an independent press office for science. And what that means is that we are not a press office like your own who does kind of showcasing of the work of any one organization. We're independent from any organizations, and our only remit is a responsible evidence-based reporting of scientific subjects in the UK news. So what that means a lot of the time is that we're sitting in that place between science and you know, which can be so slow and incremental and cautious and equivocal and kind of boring, and journalism, which is rapacious and demanding and crass, and you know, so all these things that each suffers from the stereotypes of being, and which are a little bit true. Mm. We try to bridge that gap and work with scientists and journalists to try and make sure that scientists talk about their work in a way which is accessible and interesting and available to the general public and to non-specialists, and try to help journalists get in touch with the right people quickly to inform their story.
So you mentioned two A's there, accessible and available. But there's another one, which is accuracy. I think the thing that people worry about is they'll give a story and it just won't be accurately reported.
Yeah.
How do you deal with that?
Well, if you just talk about your, you know, you give 2,000 words on your methodologies or your statistical analyses, that is not going to be reported. You need to at least meet the journalist in the middle. Try to think like they think. Try to imagine how this story is going to be told. Try to imagine telling it to your non-specialist friend or your teenage children or something like that. because that's how a story will need to be told. And if you can help translate it and keep it interesting and simplify it but not dumb it down, I mean, that's the trick, isn't it? Simplifying without dumbing it down. And if you can't simplify without dumbing it down, just dumb it down a bit. Yeah. I mean, it doesn't matter that much, does it? It doesn't matter. You can still tell, you can still get the story across without every single tiny little caveat and footnote being finding its way into those articles. So I think that's...
Thank you. So there's no link here between dumbing it down and moving on to Kate. I promise you there isn't. Because, Kate, you know, I want to say, so when I think of Reuters, I think of Reuters as a trusted news source in the same way I think as Cochrane is a trusted source for science. You work for Reuters. Perhaps you can just explain a little bit about how Reuters, you know, works and how you work within it.
Yeah, I mean, and I'm grateful for the compliments on both sides about Reuters, and I do think that on the whole we are viewed as a very trusted news source, and we try very hard to we've earned that reputation, and we try very hard to keep it. Yeah. I also would like to, you know, shout out for my colleagues in the right across the British media and the American media, which is under attack so much at the moment, that, you know, we really are not in the business of making stuff up. Mm. And it's, you know, one of the ways that I, one of the things that I find quite frustrating about the attack on journalism in general at the moment, which is obviously coming a lot from across the water, is that you know, when you ask, are there good and bad journalists? There are, indeed. Mm-hmm. But there are also good and bad scientists.
Yeah.
And I think that's... And everyone in this room will know that there are good and bad scientists. But that doesn't mean that everyone in this room is a bad scientist. So I do think that Reuters should be and is a trusted news source. But I am still trying to do the same thing as other people in my profession, which is I need people to read my stories. I need them to read them beyond the first paragraph. I need them to think that they matter to them and that they will inform their decisions about whether they quit smoking or whether they buy this product or that product or buy shares in this product or, you know, start.
So you began to answer the question, which is, you know, how would you decide then which stories to write?
Yeah, I mean,
particularly faced with 100 emails a day or whatever it is.
That's such a familiar... Thankfully, I don't actually have to pick out 15 and write five. So I get about 200 emails a day. About half of them are press releases.
Yeah.
And when I first started the job, I was just absolutely overwhelmed.
Yeah.
And obviously you start to get to know a little bit about, you know, a little bit more about who's what. But you know, one of the main filters that you would use is you know, is this a mouse? Is this a person? You know, that quite often helps. If it's a mouse, how close are we to the person, you know?
You actually ask, are you a man or a mouse?
Yes, exactly. Because, and you know, so, and this is, I mean, it's partly a Reuters kind of criteria that we've decided to, we cover a lot, far fewer stories now, but we cover them in more depth. And we also need to be somewhere close to the to the man before we're even interested. And part of the reason I do that is because I think that the potential to be misleading to your end user, who is after all not a mouse, is greater if you start with a mouse study. And I mean, I still have the whole getting through the news desk, who will sometimes say to me, you know, why did the mouse have prostate cancer?
Yeah.
And it's like, well, because they gave it prostate cancer. You know, we're still at that level, even with my news editors.
Yes.
You know, why was the mouse depressed?
Yeah.
You know, because the sun wasn't shining.
Yeah.
It is quite sort of eye-opening how many hurdles we've got to get.
And of course, you introduced this idea that you've got to get anything you write is not going straight into any newspapers. You've got a news editor there who's going to see everything.
And then it goes everywhere. But sometimes the barrier, and that, you, so, sometimes that's a good barrier because it's not a specialist news editor. They're a sort of real person, and sometimes they've got, you know, a mum with diabetes and a daughter with autism, and so they bring their own perspective to things. But sometimes if you think you're getting too close to the scientists, then somebody asking you a really stupid question like that really helps to make you realise how far you've got to go yet, even to quite an intelligent audience. So what
do we have to do in Cochrane to make the case that you open your email box and it goes ping and you say, oh, wow, there's an email from Cochrane. My day is made. Thank goodness. It's going to be a great week.
Yep.
So the question then is, so what do you need from us or what can we do that's going to help? And actually, even more simply, to help us rise like cream to the top of that pile of 100.
Well, you know, my view on that, first of all, and, you know, this is going to be a sort of a total loving, but an email from Cochrane gets read anyway because it's Cochrane, you know. So you're already way ahead of the pack because you're, you know, you have these perceived to be very high standards and a very broad base of evidence. You know, we're not doing a study on three people. It's the sort of ultimate high standard. So I will always read it. I was saying, I think that the other thing about Cochrane, which counts against them in terms of making a story, is that it is more likely to be the most balanced review of whatever. Yeah. Therefore, the caveats are going to be multiple.
We love our caveats. Yes. We've got to have the caveats. So, but you don't like them.
No, they make it less likely. I do like them. To know what they are. But it does make it less likely that it will be a sexy story, you know, because it will be... We did all of this review of all of the evidence and we've come up with, you know, something quite in the middle.
Okay.
Which is... doesn't make news.
No.
But you're not there to make news. No. You're there to, you know. A Cochrane email on the whole will get read.
Yeah.
And also knowing, and that's changed a lot recently, is knowing what's coming up so that you can plan for things coming is always very helpful. Right.
Thank you. Well, Jamie, sort of back to you. You know, were you involved in producing the press release, and did you find that a helpful and good experience?
Yes, I was very much alongside Joe and Katie's help, and I found it a vital experience actually in terms of producing that press release. I think it helps you shape the findings of your review in language that is going to be more accessible, which is really important. It's slightly different from a plain language summary, because really you're giving in some ways even less methodological detail. But what I found it really crucial for was it went through lots of checks, it went through loads of stages in terms of us all agreeing this wording, going to wider author teams, being seen by central editorial unit as well. And that then gave me talking points that I felt super confident about. So when I went into media interviews, I always had a copy of the press release printed out, and I thought, worst comes to worst, if I don't know what to say, I'm going to say, well, we didn't study that, but what we can say is, and then I'm going to read a line from our press release, because I know we agree with that, I know it's not misleading, and I know it's accessible. Mm. So I think that was a really key part for me, and also a confidence booster to have it there.
So, I mean, what sort of attitude, what's helped you most when you've been heading towards a press release? It sounds like good preparation and knowing, but it also sounds from what you say as if you've learned a few strategies. That idea of reverting back to the press release, that sounds like a learned behaviour that we can perhaps all learn from.
Absolutely. So I think reverting back to the press release, practicing in advance. So I practiced with Joe. I also practiced with our department comms officer, especially around anticipating some of those difficult questions that you think might come up, because I think in my mind those were looming quite large, and actually finding ways to respond to those was really useful to have those in advance, and also just some techniques for kind of bridging between what the question was and the answer that you were willing to give. Learning those techniques was really useful, and for me I think I also kept on feeling like, well, I am going to present quite a balanced opinion, and does that make me the person who should be talking about this? I was aware of colleagues on both sides of the argument in this particular case who were very vocal about it and therefore maybe came across as more engaging, and I thought, you know, how am I going to get my voice in there? And what I kept on reminding myself was of my faith in the Cochrane method, reminding myself of how many rounds this has gone through, and really this is the best available evidence. And if we put ourselves in the shoes of a general person in the public who wants to know something, that's what they want to know. They want an unbiased reading of it so that they can make the right decision. So kind of reminding yourself, I have a right to say this, it's actually really important information to share, even if I'm not going to be 100% on one side or the other.
Joan, not all Cochrane reviews are newsworthy, as we've heard a little bit about the fact that that's stating the obvious, but in fact, the news media are interested in stuff that is more interesting. What can we do about that?
Yeah, I think that's right, Martin. My background is as a news journalist, and I worked for the BBC as well as print journalism for 20 years, and a lot of the work that I did was general news journalism. Whereas I think what we're trying to do, we know we have the big reviews that come along that we know will have mass appeal to a general news audience. But Kate and Tom represent science and health specifically, and that's who we want to target with our publications and with the dissemination of our reviews. But then there are the big topics that come along that are pretty sexy, hot potatoes that globally will have mass appeal, and smoking is obviously one of them. I was always told that it was the five S's. I don't know whether this is still the case, Tom and Kate, but it was stress, sex, smoking, sugar, and statins.
Yeah, we've kind of moved on a little bit, maybe.
And they had general news appeal. Now, and that's great, and Jamie sits here representing one of those global health topics. But obviously a lot of what we do and a lot of our dissemination work isn't part of one of those big reviews. But there are still audiences out there, and there's still ways that we can get into the media with our science and health publications that may not be as sexy, may not be as topical, may not be as finite in its findings. And we find other ways of doing that. So as Jamie says, you know, we did some broadcast media, but we also might do some blogging, we might do some podcast. We might do a specific featured piece. We might do an editorial. And then we would find ways of contacting the right journalist in order to get them that information to them. So it might be Nature. It might be The Conversation. It might be more or less on Radio 4 here in the UK, rather than the mass market for journalists. So that's what we try and do. And I think, you know, anyone who came to any sort of dissemination workshops that Katie and I have been a part of, you know, we always try and say that we do try and make the point that there is a audience for every review, no matter whether that's one academic or one researcher, or it's a massive global public health story that has to be reported on. And I really do think that there is a journalist that would be interested in a lot of our reviews, many more than what we actually press release.
And Katie, do you use the plain language summary how do you go about selecting things?
Plain language summaries are incredibly valuable, and weekly we'll get the reviews that come through that are published, and we'll pick out the ones where we think there isn't a press release, but we still think people will be interested in those. So, for example, there was the review on breastfeeding and pain during vaccination. So we sent the plain language summary to the enemy, the Daily Mail, who I agree with Tom, actually write things up really well. And they did a lovely Saturday morning, you know, mum's drinking coffee, read about this breastfeeding during your baby's vaccination story. And that was through the plain language summary. And what happens quite often is if something appears in one media outlet, then they do this thing called syndicating. It then appears somewhere else, so you see things run and run. Another example was a blog on what's the point of paracetamol, which was done at the University of York's website. The Conversation then asked, would they write that up for The Conversation, which is this big sort of repository of articles from academics, but very well read. But they've got this public commons license, and that blog then turned up, unbeknown to us, but in 4 or 5 national papers, and also the Sydney Morning Herald and other national papers. So even if you think you're working just with a plain language summary, just giving it to one newspaper, you think this, you know, if I ring up and say, can you do this one interview? Oh my God, this is really annoying because I was going to be feeding my cat at 4 o'clock. Now I've got to talk to the journalist. It can then run and run and run. Mm-hmm. So it's worth the effort.
Can I ask a bit about timeliness? One of the things that strikes me is that when people write an email to you asking for a comment, for example, if you're a journalist writing to me, it's no good me thinking, oh, I'll deal with that on Thursday week, is
no,
it?
No,
tell,
no.
How quickly do we have
not.
To respond?
Well, I mean, you know, a lot of this stuff in this sphere, so in the health and science sphere, we have a little bit more time to play with.
Yeah.
I mean, certainly even Reuters and the deadline on Reuters is always just gone.
Yeah.
But because a lot of our stuff in this area is under embargo, I get a couple of days to try and get my head around whether it's a story or not, which means that on the whole, we have a sort of 24 to 48 hour window. But I mean, one of the things that is intensely frustrating for journalists is when you get sent a press release or and you know the authors are out of the country, or you know it's like, well, just you know, or they can't, you know, sort of unavailable to talk to me until they come back from their 2-week conference in you know wherever. Well, you know, that's just no good.
No.
So if I can't talk to the author, either give me somebody else to talk to or don't try. But on the whole, you do have to respect. It's not sort of, I need to talk to you in the next 10 minutes, but often it is also better to, I mean, you do quite a lot of this where you would call journalists and call scientists and they'll send an email comment in.
Mm.
I think sometimes scientists feel better doing that because they've kind of they've got something concrete that they've thought about. This is what I'm prepared to say, and I've written it down. And you know,
I did that for the Daily Mail last week. Actually, it's rather, in some senses, rather general, rather fatuous comments about evidence. But it was easier to think about them and put them in quotation marks and send them to Katie and send them off to the journalist because I knew that they wouldn't be misquoted.
Yes.
And it seemed to be, on that case, what they were looking for at that particular time.
But also this idea that. I do think there's always this thing about people being misquoted. You know, I don't know, but it's just a sort of complete no-no. If somebody says, if you write down something that somebody didn't say, it's just you're not doing your job properly. I mean, there is this taking out of context, and that's the sort of more subtle thing.
Yes.
But I do think that as scientists, if you're, you should take the view of me and my colleagues is the same as I view you guys. Which
so you're not
you're
talking about political journalists. You're not the same as political journalists.
No, not
Tell
at all.
Us the story about that.
Well, I mean, I used to be, so I've been at Reuters for many years, but I was, I've been in various guises, but I think the biggest contrast for me was I was in the political lobby, so I was in the lobby in Blair's, under Blair's government, and so I went to those daily briefings at Number 10 with Alistair Campbell, which was basically you just go into a boxing ring, and it's they hate you, and you hate them, and they lie to you, and you try and you know undercut them, and then they double bluff you, and it's just absolutely torturous. And it's some journalists really get off on it, and I found it incredibly combative. Actually a very unpleasant area to work in. And when I moved from political journalism to health and science journalism, I can remember going to sort of one or two press conferences at the beginning where they had done a GWAS on schizophrenia. And it was just the most intensely complicated thing I've ever been faced with. And it was sort of week one in the job. Mm. And in the end, I just said to the guy, can you just draw me a picture of this? And he drew this kind of hedgehog thing or something. It was just, but it really worked. And I just felt, gosh, I'm working as a team. I'm working with this man to get this idea so he can explain it to me and I can get it further.
Yeah.
And it was suddenly like, we're all on the same side.
Yeah.
It's not in my interest to say they found one gene for schizophrenia when they clearly haven't.
Yeah.
It's not in my interest to make the story so intensely complicated that nobody will read it. And it just suddenly felt like this is a relationship that is, you know, I don't want to trick him into saying something that he hasn't found. And he doesn't want to, you know, he still wants to tell everybody what he has found.
So you mentioned the word relationships there. Maybe just ask Tom to comment on that. Are they important? Critical?
I was going to echo that. It's mutual, isn't it? Yeah. So we're working with, you know, dozens of scientists every week on whatever story has come up, either, like Kate said, where we're trying to get third-party quotes out of you as experts in the field on a new published piece of research. And we do that, by the way, on Cochrane reviews as well. We'll get other scientists who are not authors to comment on the piece of work to help put it into context. Or we're working with you as an author, maybe at a live press briefing or something like that. But time after time after time, scientists either, they might have started confidently or they might have been terrified of the media. They go through that process and they come out the other end of it saying, oh, that wasn't as bad as I thought, or I'm really pleased about that, or when can I do it again? They see not only the value of the right message getting through to the public, but also they were just scared of what the media, you know, this kind of big untamable beast. But then, and they didn't expect that a journalist would say, okay, look, I really, really want to understand this. Can you draw me a picture? Or can you, sometimes we have press briefings, journalists will say, okay, what I want to say to my readers is such and such. And they will say a line. You've done that before. Yeah. And then the scientist will say, yeah, that's good. Oh, I'm going to use that. Or
that
it's
accurate?
Not quite.
Yeah.
It's more this thing. Yeah. And you meet in the middle, and it's a kind of, it's a two-person job, and it's done to sort of mutual satisfaction afterwards. So I think when it works well, it works really well.
And it is that whole thing about good and bad, you know, that there are some scientists, bad scientists, that I don't want to talk to.
Yeah.
So, you know, you may well have experience, as you gain experience, there will be some journalists that you decide you don't want to talk to. Absolutely fine, you know, as long as you keep talking to me, that's... but, you know, and I've been in this job, this sphere, for about 7 or 8 years, and I have some very, very good relationships that I don't necessarily write down everything they say, and I certainly don't cover everything they do, but in, you know, 3 years' time, if I am doing something on brain stuff, and Barbara Sahakian, she's one of my favourite people. I very rarely write about her research, but sometimes I do, and I have a very good relationship with her. And so, it is almost a personal thing after a number of years. And you're absolutely at liberty to choose which ones you like and which ones you don't.
Thank you.
But in terms of relationships, it's based on reputation, isn't it? And trust. And you have to, and that's mutual as well. And you know, you're. I was going to say lucky. I mean, it's by design, really. But at Cochrane, you enjoy a very good reputation. Like Kate said, your email will get read. But that is because you are known for not hyping and not spinning and not stretching, a tiny bit of data or something observational into something which is the definitive cause-effect story. And enjoy that, but live up to it as well. You will gain and maintain the trust of journalists by being those scientists and not the mavericks who will do anything to get a good story, or whose starting point is, this is what I believe, let's go and find the evidence to substantiate it. And they do exist out there, but the majority of you, like the majority of journalists, are doing an honourable job.
So with that thought ringing in our ears, can I throw the floor open for questions? If anyone has a question, if we get my colleagues to grab the microphones here. So this is that occasion when you can ask the questions that you may have always been slightly fearful of asking of people with this sort of media experience. Or maybe they've made it all sound so simple and straightforward now, you're going to all rush out and do it. But any questions or comments or stories of experiences that anyone would like to bring up? Yes, first one over here, thank you.
Hi, Tess Moore from the University of Bristol. Ages ago, Dr. Foster used to produce a Take a Break magazine type thing, which was distributed in GP surgeries. It was written by journalists, but it was evidence-based medicine. I didn't know if there's an appetite for that kind of thing again. It was like, you know, an EastEnders star talking about her experience with breast cancer and Wayne Rooney talking about doing testicular examination, but in a way that was really accessible. So I just wanted to ask about that, that kind of thing.
What was it called?
It was a really long time ago, and there was an organisation called Dr. Foster that does lots of, you must have heard of Dr. Foster, right?
Yeah.
So they employed tabloid journalists to write a Take a Break style magazine that used
to get... kind of like patient leaflets come...
Yeah, but it looked like National Enquirer.
Yeah.
And it used to just be put in GP surgeries. And it was just amazing. It was like a really cool way of getting evidence-based medicine out there. So it's not the same thing. It's not reporting results of research, but it's getting evidence-based medicine in
making it accessible.
The equivalent is like your family GP, Dr. Mark Porter, Inside Health on Radio 4. It's a family GP from Gloucestershire, and you know, kind of discovered celebrity status after being on This Morning and various, you know, breakfast red sofas. And he now has a Radio 4 programme where he talks about evidence-based, the evidence base behind a treatment or a drug. But yeah, I mean, absolutely right. And I mean, you know, last year I was at the Wiley seminar with Tanya Byron, who is a leading psychological. She did House of Tiny Tearaways, and she talks about that a lot. That actually, you know, part of our job is to just get the stories out there, and if they turn up and Take a Break or Chat or, you know, Woman's Health, then that's really good. And why shouldn't we? You know, we should be accessible. We should be have evidence-based medicine and healthcare stories available to everybody. I think what we're trying to do is slightly more targeted, and I'm not suggesting or condoning for a moment that we should go out and get in to Take a Break every day with our evidence, but it is a great way of getting out there. And I know, you know, those consumer lifestyle magazines are certainly read by a vast amount of the population still. And you can get it right or you can get it wrong. So, you know, we tend to work very hard at avoiding those dubious tabloid headlines wherever possible.
You know, these were written really,
really well.
Yeah. They were written really purposefully to be accurate, but to appeal.
I think one of the things that I think is it's so important here, if you really are very new to this idea of dealing with the media, is use Katie and Joe, because what they do for you and what they do for me is that they really do decide whether, you know, where your story should go. So I as far as I know, you would not just blanket press, you know, you wouldn't send a press release out. Sometimes you send it to everybody, but you will think very carefully about where this story is going to be useful. This is the sort of thing that Kate, because she's a bit of a nerd or whatever, will be interested in, but I'm not going to send her the thing about, you know, stress in the bath, because Reuters doesn't cover that kind of thing. And that's again where... So my sort of, that helps me filter my inbox, because I know if I've got a press release from Cochrane, it's because it's something they genuinely think Reuters would be interested in. And so if you go to them with your sort of like, I want to put this out there, but I'm worried that it's going to be get this treatment or that treatment, then their answer might be, well, let's just not send it to them, you know, let's target it at the sorts of people that mm-hmm. will treat it in the right way, or will have, you know, the conversation, that kind of the different types of media. And I think that's invaluable. I think it provides you with an expert safety yeah. net, channeling your stuff to where it needs to be.
So. I think there's an equivalent. Lots of doctors, and I speak as one, think, for example, they can do a literature search, and all the information specialists in the room know that that's just not true, you know, that you need an expert to do it. And yet we all think we can have a bit of a go at this communication stuff and perhaps write a press leaf. We've got professionals here. They've been trained to do it. You know, let's use them. But Katie, did you want to come back on the question?
I was going to say, we monitor the media every day, every week. Jack does that. So we are looking at what journalists are interested in, what subjects. So we're building up a national sense of what's going on. We've got a media list of about 150 journalists on it, and we've got a sense of what they're interested in. And that can go from something very niche to something very popular.
Yeah, thank you. Any other questions or comments? Yes, please, from the middle there. We'll get you a microphone and then...
Hi. Following on from what you were saying, aside from the dissemination, it seems that there's potential for us to use the knowledge you have about what people are interested in to inform our prioritisation. Would maybe working with Joe and Katie on behalf of Cochrane overall, there be a way forward to do that, yeah. or is it not appropriate? Or I don't know. It's just okay.
So the question was about the opposite, which is that since you know what the public seem to be interested in at the moment, could that feed into the prioritisation process? So the questions that journalists and the media and patients are asking, might that help inform the reviews that Cochrane does?
You could go back to the five S's of sex, sugar, statins and stress, and then the NHS priorities of, you know, obesity, dementia. Yeah. If you start to look at the papers and listen to the radio, this is what comes back time and time again, yeah. and common yeah. health complaints yeah. like asthma.
And there's a new S, actually, which I thought I heard Jeremy Hunt speak the other day, and his S is safety. He's very keen to promote, to look at the whole issue of safety in the NHS, so reviews on that would be welcome. Thank you. Any other questions, comments? So if not, I'm going to ask each of you, if you were to think it one piece of wisdom that you can share with us.
You're going to have to go first on this.
One summary, a point. Are you going to go first? Go on, have a go. One sort of word to leave us with.
You asked, the first question was about almost like specialist publications, and that sounds really nice, but you try to remember where the public are looking and listening, because that's where you need to be. There are a lot of people on any, so at the Science Media Centre we work on controversial stories. They are often not scientifically controversial, but they are socially or politically controversial, so climate change being the most obvious pick of those. The most people are not reading, I mean, it's really nice to be in Nature, but the public are not reading Nature. The conversation is much favoured by academics because you get to tell it in your own words. And it's a nice place to be, I've got no problem with them at all, but they are not. They are not a widely read news site. You look at something like the Daily Mail, that is the single, I think this is still true, the single most widely read news site in the world. In the world, the Mail Online. So
it has a lot of Reuters copy on it as well.
A lot of Reuters copy on it to pad it out. But you know that's where you need to be. And in these controversial subjects, and often what you're, I don't know how you pick at Cochrane. I should ask, I suppose, the reviews that you're going to do, but they are often very interesting to us, whether it be e-cigarettes, or there was one on vitamin D a while back, and asthma and things like that. They are, I'm sure you don't pick them because they make good stories, but they usually do make good stories. And things that make good stories are usually the subject of controversy, or they are a battleground in some way. And that means, just to kind of stretch that metaphor a bit, you will have enemies out there. There will be people who will devote their time to twisting the evidence, to cherry-picking the evidence to suit whatever their agenda is.
And if you are absent from that debate, as scientists largely were from the MMR debate, which went so catastrophically wrong for everybody and still does, I still know people who say, oh, vaccines, I wouldn't vaccinate my children. How do we know they're safe? And the GM debate and mad cow disease and all these things, they're huge subjects of media hype. And time and time again, we see that where scientists in their masses get involved to tell in real time, very quickly and carefully and honestly and brutally sometimes, what the evidence base actually does show on a subject, that story plays out much, much better. Mm. So as scientists, take every opportunity to engage with the public, but you ignore the mass media at your peril.
Thank you. Jamie, do you want to go next?
Yeah, so my point was, I suppose, would be going back to the discussion about relationships. For me, I think one of the very most rewarding things about being involved in science, really, is collaboration. And being involved with other people, gaining new ideas. And what surprised me from getting involved with the media was that also you still have that collaborative aspect very much, and that same reward, but you're almost opening up to a wider net. So working with the Science Media Center, working with Joe, working with Katie, really did feel like just bringing more collaborators into the net to make more valuable, more impactful research. And it's something I wouldn't kind of view the science in that way as separate from its dissemination. They're all very much the same, and you are part of a team.
Thank you. And Kate.
Okay. It's going to be sort of fairly similar, but my I suppose if I wanted to give you a piece of advice, it would be absolutely, as Tom said, do engage. So don't go away from this thinking disengagement is the best thing, because it the message, your competitors or the people who are trying to argue against you will have a voice and you won't be there. So you do engage, and if you are nervous about it, then cherry pick. Dip your toe in the water. Go via your press office and say, okay, I'm willing to do this. Who can we go to with this story? This is my piece of research. I'm worried about sort of blanket. I don't want to be rung up by 15 people at the same time. Can we just tiptoe in with this? And then I think you will hopefully learn that it can be a positive experience, and then you'll start to go further. So I would say dip your toe in the water and cherry pick your outlet or your journalist, and then hopefully it will be onwards and upwards.
Hopefully it will be you.
Yes.
Especially if it's a good story.
Thanks very much. So the three things I think I heard there: look where the public are looking and listening. It's about relationships and collaboration, and we certainly know about collaboration around here, and engage, even if it's slightly cherry-picking engagement. Everybody, thank you very much indeed. It's been a fascinating discussion, and I've certainly enjoyed talking to you, and thank you for coming and talking to us. Thank you.